Shining Light Baptist Church, whether you're viewing online or whether you're here live, amen. We do praise God for you being here. It is a bit chilly today for Arizona, and so we're turning on the heat next week. I know a lot of places have turned the heat on. Has anyone turned your heat on already? Couple, amen. All right, we'll have our heat turned on next week. It's a little chilly today for our standards and our blood. And so we'll make sure we get that on next week, amen. And we're looking forward to seeing what God's going to do. By the way, this is the last Sunday of the month, and we're in December next week. And I cannot believe how the time has flown by this year. Of course, we weren't in church for about 5 months, but I tell you, we missed those 5 months, and it seemed like time has just flown by. But we are going to still be on our Spirit of Living God theme song. But let me give some thanks to Shining Light. Mark Lennart's mother passed away this week. And we did ask you to pray for Mark Lennart and the Lennart family. And he appreciates your prayers. And we thank God for what you have done for him and the kind wishes sent to him as well. So continue to remember him in your prayers. Brother Kelly gives his thanks as well. His COVID is passed. No one else was infected. Sheila didn't get infected, neither did Trenton. And he's on the road to recovery. So he thanks you for your prayers for him as well. Well, we're going to sing our Spirit of the Living God. And so we've got the words behind us here. And you should know this by now. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. That's what we've been praying for. See, preacher, right now the cold is falling on me. Amen. I understand that. Amen. We're singing and warm up our vocal cords and kind of get ourselves worked up a little bit here so that we can feel warmer. Amen. All right. Greg's going to give us an intro. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Fill up your lungs, sing it out, and warm yourselves up. Here we go.
Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me.
Transported back and forth up to Pine Top. He said it's not the fastest trip when you have a trailer that you're pulling and you've got children, and it turns a little 5-hour trip into about a 6-hour trip and then some. So pray for them as they continue to go back and forth until things get settled. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and trust His work in our midst. Father, we thank you once again for being the Spirit of the Living God that can fall upon us afresh and anew each moment of each day for every opportunity, Lord, for us to worship you in spirit and in truth. I thank you so much for being a God that forgives, a God that loves, a God that saves, a God that provides, and a God that guides through unchanging times. And thank you during this pandemic. Lord, you have steered us and maneuvered us around obstacles and through tragedies and through difficulties and through hardships. And Lord, even the good times you have blessed us with throughout this time. We want to give you the honor, we want to give you the praise and the glory. Help our viewers online that are watching remotely to receive a blessing from the service today. And help those that were able to be out this morning, Lord, to glean a blessing as well from your word. Lord, deliver to us that which we need to hear to make our lives. lives more pleasing in your sight, Lord, and we may affect more people for the glory of God and for the cause of Jesus Christ. We thank you so much for loving us, Lord. Meet with us now, and Lord, may you get all the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. A couple of quick items I want to bring up to you this morning. Make sure that on your tithing and your stewardship, you're being faithful to that. We still have needs. We still have electric bill and all those other things and mortgage and things like that. So make sure that we're being faithful with our tithes and our offerings. And also make sure that we're having a creative touch in our outreach, getting out of track, inviting someone out, telling them about the love of God, and your mannerisms, just making sure that we're doing those things that are pleasing in God's eyes, because we have to be creative in our outreach during this time. And then a couple other things here, in regards to next year, our calendar is going to have to be fluid. What do I mean by fluid? It's going to kind of come and go. Amen. Right now we're having just the morning service. We're not sure when we're going to do the evening services, the Sunday schools, the Wednesdays. But be patient with us as we try to maneuver through this. And the calendar is going to be very fluid next year as we adjust to some things. We'll have the same identical theme as this year because we had 5 months of messages that we missed from last year. So our theme is going to be the same next year, and that is the Lord is my, and the Lord is. We'll continue that theme next year, and we will also have a budget meeting coming up here very soon as well. We're going to keep the same budget because nothing really has changed with that. It's kind of unfair to base a budget off of this year's activity, and that's normally what we do. So we're going to have the same budget, but we'll have that information before you, as well as the budget that we have so far this year and the coming weeks. So do be aware of those changes coming up and some of the things that will happen over the course of the next few months. And so we're just trusting God to work in our midst. You be patient, and we're just trying to go through this like everybody else is. We do praise God for the opportunity. Amen. All right, well, we do have another song. How many of y'all know that God is good? Amen. God is so good. He's so good to me. Amen. We're going to sing that song. I love this song. Amen. God is so good. He is so good to me. So, Gene, give us an intro on that one. Trust, amen. God is so good. First stanza, here we go.
God is so good.
Turn it on. And then when you do turn it on, you push too many buttons. buttons, amen?
Right.
And so that's what happened here. I didn't have it turned on. I just told Josh before the service, he said, you got it? I said, yep, and I know to turn it on, too. And I'm glad I turned it on, but I turned it on the last minute. Amen. Y'all work with me. I'm not used to all these electronic gadgets and stuff like that. So, but God is still so good. Amen. Whether I can work the gadget or not, God is so good. Amen. And in case you missed it, it was God is so good. He died for me. He answers prayer. I love him so. I'll do his will. He's coming soon. Amen. So hum that the rest of the day, amen, and you will be blessed, amen. All right, well, hopefully you got a good laugh in seeing what I didn't do up there and it warmed you up some, amen. Because I know I did, praise the Lord. All right, well, you know, a lot of things are going on in our world. Continue to pray for our elections and the transition of power that's going to take place here in the beginning of next year. Of course, the season is coming up now. Jesus is still the reason for the season. Christmas is upon us. Again, be careful, continue your social distancing, continue washing of your hands, covering your mouth when you cough, all those things that have got us this far, you want to make sure that we continue to do those things to keep those that we love safe around us and keep yourself safe as well. Amen. Well, we're going to be going right back to the way we started the services after the pandemic, and that's going to be in Luke chapter 10, verses 41 and 42, talking about investing in what cannot be taken away. So if you want to get your Bibles ready, Luke 10, verses 41 and 42, Mrs. Dawson is going to come up and sing for us here in a moment. Amen. And then we will pick up with Luke chapter 10, verses 41 and 42. Again, thank you for your patience over these past several months. And it's not been easy for me. I'm sure it's not been easy for you either. But Mrs. Dawson is going to sing. And I have a blessing for you. Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Dawson. Writ and read. Amen. Of course, that's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ and the cross of Calvary, the price that was paid for you, the price that was paid for me. Amen. Don't forget to keep both of these up. Amen. I get a chance to walk a little bit further today than I have walked in recent days. Amen. Not much further. Amen. But a little bit. So praise God for that. Well, it is cold, and so hopefully we'll heat you up and they'll let you out. It'll be warmer outside than it is inside. Amen. Take your Bibles, and if you would, go to the Gospel of Luke. We're going to be in Luke chapter 10, verses 41 and 42. And if you're able, go ahead and stand with me. And we're picking back up. We started after the pandemic talking about investing more in what cannot be taken away. We found out that a lot of things can be taken away. Grocery stores, toilet paper, Lysol. By the way, Lysol's still kind of hard to find. Amen. And other products that were in high demand were taken away from us. The attendance in the church was even taken away from us. Many other things were taken away. But we want to make sure that we're investing in that which cannot be taken away. Mary and Martha are going through a scenario with preparations for Jesus. And Mary is given the encouragement that she has invested in the right thing. And we want to make sure that we are investing in that which cannot be taken away. Luke chapter 10 and verses 41 and 42. Read those with me. Amen. Here we go. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. But one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. Father, bless these next moments that we have together, and I pray that there's a soul here that does not know about Jesus Christ, that man, woman, boy, or girl would receive Christ before it's everlasting too late. They would understand what's going on in their lives and their hearts and why they need Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Lord, I do pray that we'll understand that's something that cannot never be taken away from us. Open our minds, open our hearts to apply the Word of God today, and may the balm of Gilead from the precious Word of God or go out and minister to hearts and minds and lives all across the nation today. We'll thank you for what you're going to do in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, going back to the same theme, I think it's very, very important that we have the memory or the understanding of how to invest in the things that cannot be taken away. So far, we looked at the definition of investment. Investment means this: to expend time, to expend money, or to expend effort or energy to achieve a profit. Most of us want a profit, amen. By the way, Thanksgiving has come and gone. Most of us have profited by pounds, amen. We gained a few pounds, amen. The sweets have been eaten. The turkey has been consumed. The ham is still there. And the stuffing is coming. And we have invested in eating. And now the profit that we show is weight gain, amen. Don't go on a diet yet, because probably you're going to get a little bit more food at Christmas time, amen. New Year's is going to start, amen. That's the time to start dieting, although you want to eat sensibly, amen. So investment, to spend time, money, effort, or energy to achieve a profit. And we've seen that we should invest more in the person of God in Christ Jesus. Why? He cannot be taken away. We also saw that we should invest more in the promises of God and the Word of God, because they can't be taken away. And today we're going to see how we need to invest more in the power of God through the Holy Spirit. Why? He can't be taken away. Amen? Once we get a filling of the Holy Spirit, we're saved. He does not leave. Amen? By the way, aren't you glad you don't have to pray like David, take not thy Holy Spirit from me? Amen? Hold your finger there. Well, again, yeah, hold your finger there. Go back to Psalm 51. David here, of course, you know, he sinned with Bathsheba. And God began to mete out some punishments on him, if you would, some disciplines on him. David was horrified that God was not going to use him anymore. And so in Psalm 51, you find his penitential prayer asking God for forgiveness. But notice what he says down in verse 11. Matter of fact, start in verse 10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right, was that spirit within me. But then notice what he says in 11. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. When the Spirit of God was on a person in the Old Testament, it was for the purpose of using them, and they were anointed with the Spirit of God. But he didn't permanently indwell them until the New Testament. And so taking away the Holy Spirit was saying, I'm going to take away your usefulness. You don't have my anointing and my power like you used to. I'm so glad I don't have to pray, Lord, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Amen. By the way, the New Testament does say that if you don't have the Spirit of God, you're none of his. Amen. And so the Spirit of God is that seal, that person who lets you and I know that we belong to God. Amen and amen. David said, look, I don't want your Holy Spirit to leave me. Don't take it away. I'm so glad I don't have to pray like that. Don't take thy Holy Spirit away from me. Over the next few weeks, I'm going to be preaching on investing more in the Holy Spirit. Why? He's a person you can't see. He's a power you can't settle, and a promise you can't shake. Amen. Think about that. And he's a person you can't see. So I've got to invest in somebody that I can't see. And then a power you can't saddle. Normally you saddle a horse, amen, and you bridle the horse. Guess what? The Holy Spirit's got to saddle you, amen, and bridle you. And then a promise you can't shake. You can't get away from the promise that God has given you through the Holy Spirit, amen. And so we're going to be looking at those over the next coming weeks. But today we're going to be talking about investing more in the person you can't see. Now, how do you invest in a person you can't see? Let me give you some practical notes of what we invest in without saying. And don't laugh when you hear these, amen? And by the way, these can all be taken away. We invest in the bank with our money for a profit, do we not? Yeah. But we don't see the process. You don't see all the hands that the money goes through. You don't even see the teller. She's behind some booth back there, amen? We invest in the internet, check this out, with our credit card number, our social security number, and our bank information for purchases, and we don't see the people. Amen. Hey, I'm with you. I go to Amazon and PayPal and Walmart and rest of them too. Amen. We invest in online purchases with our 3-digit security code for proof, and we don't see the people. Think about it. They ask you your 3-digit code. Hey, you got to get that 3-digit code along with your zip code, along with your address. And so all these persons and peoples we can't see. We invest in the bank for a profit. We don't see the process. We invest in the internet with our credit card, social security number, bank information for purchase. We don't see the people. We invest in online purchases with our 3-digit security code for proof. And all those can be taken away from us. Amen. You can invest your money in that and never see the thing come to your doorstep. It happened to us over the summer. Amen. More than once. And so we want to talk about investing more in the power of God through the Holy Spirit of God. We already know that we invest in things without seeing. So now we want to invest in that which we can't see, which can't be taken away. Amen? Why? Because this is something that God wants for us. Let's invest more in the power of God through the Holy Spirit of God. Think back with me. At the time of your salvation, you invested your soul. I invested my soul in a person we couldn't see. Go back to 1 Peter chapter number 1, verse 8. 1 Peter 1:8. Because we're talking about investing in this person you can't see. 1 Peter 1:8. And in 1 Peter, notice what Peter says down here in verse number 8, speaking about Jesus Christ. Whom having, what's that word? Not seen, you love. In whom, though now ye what? See him not, yet, what's the word? Believing. Ye what? Rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. We've not even seen Jesus yet. We can't see Jesus yet. And guess what? We believe in Jesus and have joy about it. It's unspeakable joy and full of glory, and we can't see him. So we trusted our souls with Jesus Christ whom we cannot see. Should we not trust the Holy Spirit too? Mm-hmm. Amen? And we should. We should invest more in him. Amen? Verse number 8 again. Whom having not seen ye love, and whom though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. The world cannot see Jesus nor the Holy Spirit. Go back to John chapter 14. John chapter 14 with me. And of course, in John chapter 14, most of you know this is Jesus speaking to his disciples. And speaking to his disciples, they're troubled because he's about to leave. And I don't know about you, but anytime you begin talking about this passage of Scripture, I'm reminded of children when they leave the home and they start getting older. G2's got about 2 more years left, he'll be gone, amen? And I'm always already thinking about him leaving, like, okay. Is he going to do what he knows how to do? Is he going to be right? Is he going to be well? Is he going to be safe? All those things, amen. And there's going to be a separation there. So I'm going to have to get an iPhone so I can FaceTime with him just to make sure he's okay. He's shaving and cutting his hair and things like that, amen. So when you look at this period of time here, the disciples are troubled. They're worried. They're kind of skittish about Jesus leaving them. And notice what it says down in verse number 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world, what's the word? Cannot receive, because it what? Seeth him not, neither what? Knoweth him. But notice what he says about the disciples. But ye, what's that? Know him. For he what? Dwelleth with you, and what? Shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. The word comfortless there is very interesting word. It means to abandon or to leave as an orphan. To leave fatherless. That's the word, the meaning of the word there. When he says, I will not leave you comfortless. He says, I will not leave you abandoned or without a father. I will not leave you as an orphan. I'm going to be with you, but in a different way. In a different way. And so the context down here, starting in verse number 1, has a variety of different applications to the word know, like we have the word know there in verse 17. Those who said down there, even the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. That word there, know, means to have a knowledge of and to abide with. But all throughout this passage, there are other applications of the same word, but different. And they range from this, to have a conscious knowledge of someone, like a passerby, that you pass by, or to have casual knowledge, like a neighbor or coworker, or to have a common knowledge, like a friend, we have things in common, and then a close knowledge, like a spouse with an intimate knowledge. The one that Jesus is using there in verse 17 is talking about that intimate knowledge that they're going to have with Jesus Christ as he's going to be with them by the Spirit's power. Notice verse 7, because Jesus is talking about how he's going to go away. Matter of fact, most of us know this passage, so let's just kind of step down through a couple of areas here. Notice in verse number 4, and whither I go, here's the word, ye know, and the way ye know. So in other words, he said, you have knowledge of that. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest. And how can we know the way? He said, we don't have knowledge of that. But then come back down to verse number 7. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. So Jesus said, if you had this intimate knowledge of me, which I know you do, then you should have intimate knowledge of my Father. Look what he says, verse 8. Philip saith unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Verse 9, Jesus said unto him, have I been so long time with you? Yet hast thou not known me? In other words, have an intimate understanding of me, Philip. He that has seen me has seen the Father, and how sayest thou then, show us the Father? He goes down to speak to them about what he's done by way of works, and they should really know who he is. And then he comes down to verse 16, he says, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. Notice who he is, verse 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither what? Knoweth him, or has not an intimate relationship with him, or has not him abiding with them. He says, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless or abandoned or orphaned. I will come to you. Of course, Jesus speaking of the Spirit of God, he said, look, I'm going to go away to my Father's house.
And he's saying, if you know the Father, if you know me, you know the Father. And they said, well, no, we don't understand. We don't understand. He said, no, if you know me the way you say you know me, then you know my Father. They said, well, we don't really understand. He said, well, do you know what I've done? I've opened blind eyes. I've healed the lepers. I've raised them. Do you know what I've done? We got that. He said, well, then you should know only the Father can do that. And I and my Father are one. But he said, there's somebody coming to help you understand more about who I am, who my Father is, in retrospect to who you are. And his name is the Comforter of the Spirit. He said, now the world can't see him. The world doesn't know him. He said, but you don't know him. What I want to talk about today is investing more in this person you can't see by way of the Spirit. By way of getting to know the Spirit better. By the way, you can always know the Spirit better. You can always know the Spirit better. Until we get to glory is when we stop knowing the Spirit the way we should, amen? All down through here in the flesh, we're not going to really comprehend and know the Spirit the way we should. In verse 17, there's that world's inability to comprehend. It said the world cannot because it doesn't see him and doesn't know him. But the Christian has an ability. He says, you know him, he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. And so there four ways that you and I can know the Spirit of God. It's either going to be in a conscious knowledge or like a passerby. You go to the store and you pass by somebody. You don't know them, do you?
No.
You walk down the sidewalk, you pass by someone. You don't know them. I can also have a casual knowledge of someone like my neighbor on my right hand or on my left hand or a coworker that I work with. I can also have a common knowledge, a friend, things that we have in common. We have common interests. We have common knowledge. Christians have common interests, common knowledge. But what Jesus is wanting you and I to have with the Holy Spirit is a close knowledge. The intimate. The trust relationship. The caring relationship. The going through the times of trial relationship and still trusting him. The close knowledge. And Jesus used a variation of those definitions throughout this passage. We use the word know and knoweth. By the way, we must get to know the Spirit of God better if we're going to know Jesus better. We must get to know the Spirit of God better if we're going to know God better. We must get to know the Spirit of God better if we're going to know each other better. If you haven't figured it out, we're not all the same. We're all different. You come up for Thanksgiving, some people like green peas, others don't. Some like ham, others don't. Some like turkey, others don't. Some like roast beef, others don't. Some like mashed potatoes, others don't. Some like carrots, others don't. Some like cherry pie, if you're right with God, you will, amen. Others don't. And so whatever it is that you and I have, we've got to understand the Spirit better to understand one another. You know, there are those that absolutely don't like brownies. I think they're not right with God to not like brownies. But there are those that don't. There's some folks that don't like oatmeal raisin cookies and chocolate chip cookies, amen. Now, I am one of those that I don't like pudding. I don't like vanilla cream pudding. I don't like Jell-O. I don't like whipped cream. Don't like anything mushy like that in my mouth. Amen. It just makes me love you. Everybody in my family loves those things. Not me. I don't like vanilla ice cream. Unless I have chocolate going on top of it. To turn it into chocolate ice cream. Amen. I'm just funny like that. And so, with us being different, we have to know the Spirit of God better to understand each other better. Just because people don't like cherry pie doesn't mean that they're not right with God, amen? I think they are, but, I'm just thinking with you, amen? And so, I just want to give you a couple of quick things to think about today as we look at how we can invest more in the person you can't see, amen? And by the way, we can't see the Spirit of God either, but we know him. And we know he's present in us. You say, preacher, well, if we can't see him, how do we know he's present in us? Well, of course, you're taken by faith. But there's another way that we can know that the Spirit of God is present with us. Say, preacher, with that, the telltale sign
is that we grieve him. Amen. We grieve him. Go to your Bibles, Ephesians 4:30. Ephesians 4:30. How can I invest in a person I cannot see? Well, first of all, recognize that he is within me and I can grieve him. And we grieve him and he lets us know about it. Notice Ephesians 4:30. And it says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. There's a couple things there. The first thing is that you can actually grieve the Holy Spirit of God. Grieve means to make him pain. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. Notice, and whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. So he can be pained, but you and I are sealed by the same one. Sealed by the same one, amen? And by the way, when we eat something our bodies dislike or is bad for you, your bellies ache, amen? Hopefully nobody got a bellyache over Thanksgiving, amen? But now you let that turkey stay in that refrigerator about 3-4 weeks and without freezing it or something like that, and you go back and try to eat some of it. I guarantee it'll pain your stomach, amen? You let that stuffing stay in there about 3-4 weeks without putting it in the freezer. I guarantee you it'll pain your stomach, amen? You let some other things that you cooked on Thanksgiving stay in your refrigerator 3, 4, 5 weeks, and you go back and try to eat it. I guarantee it'll pain your stomach. If not, you must have a cast iron stomach, amen? Because that is not meant to be there that long. So we eat something our bodies dislike or is bad for us, our bellies ache. And like bad food hurts your belly, sin grieves the Holy Spirit. And he lets you know about it by grieving, by feeling pain. And when he feels pain, guess how you feel? Pain, amen? You should feel pain. And you should feel his pain, amen? Your belly tells you when something is bad by aching. The Holy Spirit tells you when something is sin by grieving, amen? And so it works that way. So even though we are investing in this person we can't see, we know he's there because he grieves. By the way, people grieve in different ways, different times, and different opportunities. Mark Lenard is grieving now and over the loss of his mother. But not everybody's going to grieve the same at the same time. You know one thing that the Spirit of God always grieves over? Sin. He always grieves over sin. The problem comes is that we can shut him down. We can become desensitized, if you would. Or anesthetized to sin so much that we just shut them off. And that's the thing that you don't want to do. The Bible says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. So the person that you can't see, we need to invest in. Sometimes you may not know what you ate, but you still have a bellyache. Have you ever had that, amen? Your belly aches, but you don't have a clue what made you sick. What do? When we don't know what we ate, we try to rehearse what we ate to find out what it was, amen? When it was and what it did to us, amen? So when the Holy Spirit is grieving, you don't know why, guess what you have to do? You got to use the Word of God to find out, where did I step off wrong? Where did I get out of the will of God? What happened that caused him to grieve that's making me grieve now? Because you're not going to always know what it was, amen? By the way, when I was a baby Christian, I did so many things. I didn't have a clue what I was doing. But you know how I felt? Bad. And I thought, well, why am I feeling so bad? Then you have to go down the little trail to find out what you did. And guess what? When you find it, get rid of it. You find that dressing, get rid of it. Found that turkey, get rid of it. Whatever it is, get rid of it. Why? You don't want anybody else to eat and get a bellyache. And you definitely don't want to eat it again and get another bellyache. Amen. I've had enough bellyaches in my life, and they do not feel good. So when you trace down and you look into the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit finds out what it is, then you've got to get rid of it. When the Holy Spirit is grieved and you don't know why, use the Word of God to find out. Hold your finger there. Go back to Ephesians. Go over, I should say, Ephesians 6:17. I've mentioned this before, and I'll mention it again. Why do we want to invest in this? Because this cannot be taken away. Ephesians 6 and verse 17. Notice what it says, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the who?
Spirit.
Spirit, which is the Word of God. And I pointed that out before for a purpose, and I'm going to say the same thing again this time. We think this is our sword. How many of you ever heard that the Bible is called a sword? The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. This is not our sword. You and I are very unskillful in using this. You know whose sword it is according to that verse right there? The sword of the Spirit. He knows how to use it. And he instructs you on how to administer it. If you try to use it yourself, you're going to slice somebody in half. Amen. How many of y'all know how to cut a turkey? My wife found out the official way how to cut a turkey. I mean, most folks just get there with the butcher knife, and I mean, you just butcher that thing up. You cut everything, you know, and you get out in pieces all over the place. My wife found out the way to cut a turkey, the official way. Man, we had turkey, cut it on the grain. I mean, man, it looks good. I mean, it looked good to play. We didn't want to eat it, man. We did, though. But, I mean, it looked so good the way she cut it. I thought, man, I just get the knife and get cut off the breast right here, cut off the leg here. Cut a little bit here and cut across that way. Who wants some white meat? Who wants dark meat? And just start cutting. Man, she's got a system to it. Man, it makes a difference when the sword is in the right hands. And she cut that thing. I said, you go. That looked good. You know, the sword in the wrong hands can do a lot of damage. We wonder sometimes why we don't get the results from the Word of God in somebody's life that we thought we should get. We wonder why we don't get the results in our own lives that we thought we should get. It could be that the sword is in the wrong hands. The Bible says down there, verse 17, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The sword's got to be in the Spirit's hands. And let the Holy Spirit use his sword to point out to you and to me what we need. Amen. One of the best ways we can invest in the Spirit of God is let him have his way. Let him have his way. If you and I had our way, we would be the most miserable. I know my kids had their way, they would be miserable. They would. Joshua would have no teeth left because he likes sweets. Faith, she'd be a mess because she's like mom. She wants everything mom does. G2 would just be G2. We would all be a mess if we all had our own way. We would. I would be. I'd be a mess if I had my way. I'm so ate up. I like things so clean. I want the kids to wash their feet before they get in the shower. So they don't dirty up their pussy before. And that's ate up. When you're that bad, you know, washing feet before you get in the shower, that's bad. That's just bad. You know, but there are some people like that just ate up. Just OCD-itis, amen. Wash your feet before you get in the shower. I don't want it dirty. Hey, whenever you throw something in the garbage, take it out right away so it's never anything in the garbage. If I had my way, I would be so much of a mess. I'm so glad I got the Holy Spirit to balance me out. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about, amen. People get the toothpaste and squeeze it from the top and you get it like, bro. I'm just saying, we left ourselves, we'd be a mess. Folks, we have to invest more in this person we can't see. Give you four quick things here that we need to do in order to improve in this investment. Number one, we've got to spend time understanding who the Spirit is. We've got to spend some time understanding who he is. We've got to look at the Word of God and see who he is and what he's trying to do in our lives. Because he's there for a reason. He is another person of the Trinity. And he has a specific function in your life. And he does a ministry in your life. But we've got to spend that time understanding who he is. And then we've got to spend some time together with him. And say, okay, Holy Spirit, what do you want? Where do you want to take me today? What do you want me to do? You know, sometimes you want to speak and Holy Spirit says, don't speak. You know, there's some times when you don't want to speak and Holy Spirit says, speak. So I've got to have that time. And I've got to have that togetherness with the Spirit of God to get on board with him. Because again, the point we're going to talk about next week is he's a power you can't saddle. You don't get on the Holy Spirit and say, get up, Holy Spirit, come on. Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, you don't give him like a horse and a chariot. No, his job is to saddle you. You have the problem, not him. It's your tongue that has the problem, not his. It's your habits that have the problem, not his. It's your lifestyle's problem, not his. So you don't get him, the Holy Spirit. Say, all right, come do my bidding, Holy Spirit. Come on, God, yeah. Whoa, Holy Spirit. Whoa, we arrived. Yeah, you arrived. The Holy Spirit seems to arrive. Amen. And so I spend some time with the Holy Spirit, understanding him. I get together with the Holy Spirit, wondering what he wants me to do. Then I've got to spend some time learning from his training. He does need to train you and I. Why? We have not arrived. Amen. I don't know about you, I'm still learning more things about the Holy Spirit and about me that I didn't know. I tell you what, with 5 months, when we stopped church in March and didn't pick back up until August, I learned a lot about me during that time. I learned a lot of things of what I need and what I don't need. I learned a lot of things that I was trusting and things that I wasn't trusting that I should have been trusting. A lot of things that I trusted were taken away from me. And God said, now what are you going to do? I said, panic. He said, why panic when you can pray? Simple things like that. So folks, I'm still in the training mode as you should be as well, investing more in time, investing more in togetherness, investing more in training, and then lastly, investing more in trusting. The Holy Spirit does know what he's trying to do in your life. He does know what he's trying to do in my life. He does know what he wants from you. He does know what you can give him. But you have to do that. So how are we going to invest more in the person you can't see? Investing more in time. Investing more in togetherness. Investing more in his training. And investing more in trusting him. You know, the more you trust him, the more you trust yourself less. And that's just a given. The more you trust him, the less you trust yourself. Amen. By the way, I don't know if you're like me, but when the pandemic set in, I found that I was doing a whole lot of trusting in me. A whole lot of trusting in me. I was trusting a whole lot in my schematics and my methodology. I was trusting a whole lot in the church and what the church could do for me and how the church could provide for me. I was trusting a whole lot of things that were just taken away just like that. And now it's gone. And God said, oh, you trusted in church, you trusted in this, but how much did you invest in me? How much did you invest in the Word? How much did you invest in the Spirit of God to guide you when all those things are taken away? And I came up pretty lean. And God said, let's go back to some time together, some training, so that you can trust me and not things that can be taken away. Folks, ask yourself these questions. How well do we know the Holy Spirit? Do I have a conscious knowledge of the Spirit of God? Do I just know he's there, he exists? Or do I have a casual knowledge? Do I know him like I know my neighbor or my coworker? Do I have common knowledge of the Spirit of God? We have some things in common like a friend. Or do I have that close knowledge like I know my spouse, that intimate relationship? By the way, if we're all honest, we can know our spouses more. We can know our children more. Our children can know us more. The intimate, close relationships that we have can always get more intimate, more close. Why? Because we should be changing day by day. But we all, with open faith, beholding as in a glass, the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So as we're changing, and the Spirit of God is changing us, we are going to have to get to know ourselves and others a little better. How much are you investing in the person you can't see? More time, more togetherness, more training, more trust. I would say this, if you never trusted Christ as your Savior today, you won't do that. Don't wait another day. David had to pray, take not thy Holy Spirit from me, but according to the Bible, we're sealed into the day of redemption once we trust Christ. Say, preacher, how do I get saved? Number one, understand what you're saying. There's no righteousness in my heart. all your sin and come show you what you're like. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe on his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And then, in prayer, call upon him. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Why? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Folks, we have trust in the person we can't see. We can't see Jesus. We can't see God. We can't see the Spirit. But we know he's there. He convicts us, and he convinces us of our sin. And he helps convince you that Jesus Christ died for you, was buried for you, and rose again for your dead. Let's take the time to invest more in a person we can't see. Father, thank you so much for your goodness. Thank you for investing in us first. You loved us so much that you gave your best for us. Lord, thank you so much that we can in turn invest more in you. We can spend more time learning about the Spirit. We can spend more time together agreeing with the Spirit and what he wants to do. We can spend more time investing in the training that he desires to give us. And we can spend more time trusting what he says in your flat. Help us to improve in this investment, that the prophet will be seen as the days go by. Lord, I pray for that man, that woman, or boy, or girl that is here today, or that's listening online, that has never trusted you as Savior. Help them to, in humility, agree with you that they're a sinner. And agree with you that you love them so much that you gave Jesus Christ to die for their sins and bury and rise here with their day. Lord, help them to, in simple prayer, ask you to save them. For whosoever shall call upon you, the Lord shall be saved. Help them to rise up from prayer triumphant, knowing that Christ is their Savior. Lord, there's one here in this auditorium that has never trusted your Savior. Help them to seek out myself, Mrs. Dawson, our pastor, Mrs. White, and one of our deacons' wives, to help them with this. We thank you, Lord, and love you. Work in us now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, and looking around. Just for a moment, contemplate your own heart. How's your investment in a person you can't see? How's that time? How's that togetherness? How's the training? And how's your trust in the Spirit of God? It is not what it needs to be. Ask God to take you from a conscious knowledge to a casual knowledge. From a casual knowledge to a common knowledge, and from a common knowledge to a close knowledge of our Savior. As the music plays, you speak to God in your own heart. Ask God to help you invest. Investing more in a person you can't see. But we do it all the time.
system for your life, for my life.
can't see. But we practice this with things on a routine or regular basis. Lord, let's practice it more with the Spirit of God investing. And the person we can't see, those we can get dividends on times, spiritually speaking, that will never leave us. And we can carry into eternity. Thank you so much for loving us. Help us, Lord, with the fact of the knowledge that we know the Spirit can be grieved. And when we grieve the Spirit, help us to spend the time, the togetherness, and get the training that we need to trust Him more, not to grieve by Him further, but to get those things settled. Lord, be on the right track and on the right road to what You would have us to do. The Holy Spirit is a person of the Trinity that we can't see. But yet, so we can invest in Him more. God, help us to do that which we need to do. Assess each, every heart here, and help us to do what only Almighty God can do through the Word of God and through the sword of the Spirit, to do the surgical work that needs to be done in our lives. And help us, Lord, to enjoy the remainder of today. And then, Lord, see a change in our lives, and see a change in our heart. Lord, may we leave here differently than when we came in, a little bit more knowledgeable about investing in this person we can't see, spending that time, that togetherness, that training, that trust, doing what You would have us to do. Dismiss us with Thy blessing. Save that man and Lord, our brother's lost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Folks, I appreciate your patience and putting up with the cold here. I guarantee you when you step outside, it will feel much, much warmer than it is here. The heat will be back on next week, and so we're looking forward to getting the heat there. Make sure you say hello to one another. Amen. Keep your social distancing. Rihanna, how much longer are you here? Leave at 12. So Rihanna's here for a couple more weeks. Make sure you come around and see. Say hi to Brianna and tell Joe we said hello as well. Amen. It's been good having them here. Amen. How many had to work yesterday? Black Friday. Mr. White? Brother Hall?
Black Friday?
Heidi? Oh, no. Black Friday. Yeah. Friday. I mean, we had to work on Friday.
I didn't work on Friday.
Colin, yesterday, Black Friday. Amen. I feel so sorry for y'all. Amen. We got to sit around with fat bellies. Amen. And enjoy the fat belly syndrome. But pray that y'all get next Thanksgiving day afterwards off. Amen. Pastor, well, I know he got the day off. Amen. He bragged about having the day off. Dismiss us with a word of prayer, please.
It is good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen.
Amen.
You know, I hope y'all had a fulfilled Thanksgiving. But the message this morning just tops it all off. Amen. Know that we have a Holy Spirit of God that works in us and through us, and He's our comforter. Amen. But just a good to be here this morning. I enjoyed my Friday off. I tell you, I just stayed a little busy. I can make sure I kept my honeybee things done. I know, you know, she checks those things off to make sure when she come in that I did all those little things I'm supposed to do. And I still ate. Amen. All right, y'all get that as well. But anyway, but let's go to the Lord in prayer. But those that are listening online, if you haven't already given, you can mail your tithe into the church. We'll take care of that way. And those of you here this morning, we have a tray in the back. If you want to leave that here or up front here as we dismiss. Those that are to my right, we ask that you would go exit this way. Those on my left, back door there and out, we want to maintain our social distancing. If you want to hang around and talk outside, it is more welcome to do that. But we want to make sure that we do practice those things that we are being accustomed to knowing in the last couple of weeks. But let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask God's blessings as we depart here this morning. Father, thank You again for Your blessings. God, we thank You for the privilege that we have this morning to be in Your house. We thank You truly so much for Your Spirit of God that uses the sword of the Spirit of God to work in our lives, Lord, in a special way. Again, we just love You and thank You for this holiday season that's upon us, and even Thanksgiving as we reflect about back on the many, many things that we have to be thankful for. And we're truly thankful this morning that we could assemble in Your house. We do pray for those that are listening online that You continue working their lives as well, and they may sense Your presence. But we be with us now as we depart. Bring us back at the appointed time, and we'll be careful now to thank You and praise You for all that You've done. We're looking forward to the season that You are the reason for that's upon us as well. But bless us now, I pray, as we depart. We ask these things now in Jesus' name for His sake. Amen.